Well, hello and welcome to today's Request for Concept Papers discussion. Thank you for joining us today to learn more about the AmeriCorps VISTA program and the process for requesting VISTA resources. In addition to our great AmeriCorps webinar support team from our partners from LSI, Mike and Steve, you just heard from Mike, today you're going to hear from three staff members from AmeriCorps, the federal agency that administers the AmeriCorps VISTA program. You may also know our agency by our legal name, the Corporation for National and Community Service. We just changed it to AmeriCorps recently. So if you are wondering if CNCS is the same place, we are the same place as AmeriCorps. So my name is Rob Cox, and I'm the director of the Program Impact and Operations Team for AmeriCorps VISTA based in Washington, DC. I am a proud VISTA alum. I served in the District of Columbia from 2002 to 2004 and have stayed involved in national service for over 15 years in a number of roles, including working with the Senior Corps program on research and evaluation activities. I am joined by an all-star team today. Starting clockwise, Stephanie Reitzman is the Senior Advisor on Policy and Programming Matters for VISTA. She began with national service as a VISTA member in Helena, Montana, and has remained committed to national service, acting in a number of roles, including nearly 12 years of AmeriCorps field experience in Nevada, Oregon, Washington, and Alaska, and nearly 3 years with the VISTA headquarters team in Washington, D.C. Stephanie's love for national service extends to her family as she met her husband, a fellow VISTA alum, while serving in Montana. And their daughter was born during VISTA's 50th anniversary celebration just over 5 years ago. Kelly Daly is the lead program specialist for our team. Kelly joined the agency in 1991 after her Peace Corps service in Tunisia. First managing VISTA and Senior Corps projects in our Virginia office and then transferring to Washington, D.C. headquarters and ultimately VISTA. Kelly's a superstar. She works in a variety of roles from policy to programming to systems, and just thrilled to have both of them with us today. So what exactly are we talking about today? Well, we're gonna focus on giving you the basic information you need to decide if AmeriCorps VISTA resources are a good fit to help your organization and your community. So if that sounds of interest, you're in the right place. And to do that, we're gonna cover what AmeriCorps VISTA is, what's the VISTA program's principles and our priority areas. We'll talk about roles and responsibilities, both of an AmeriCorps VISTA member and of a VISTA sponsoring organization. We'll cover how to apply for VISTA resources. We'll look at the application process and focus on the first steps. And lastly, we'll point you to additional resources so that you can learn when, where, and how to access the support we have to help you develop a VISTA project. We expect to have about 5 to 10 minutes at the end of this presentation for questions, if all goes according to plan, and we're excited to share this info with you today to help you decide if taking the next step to join our national service community is right for you. So let's just jump right in and focus on AmeriCorps VISTA. AmeriCorps is the federal agency connecting individuals and organizations through service and volunteering to tackle the nation's most pressing challenges. And VISTA is the national service program in AmeriCorps that strengthens efforts to eliminate and alleviate poverty through volunteering and the mobilization of resources. VISTA has four core principles that guide our work and the work that sponsors and members do in their communities. The first principle is fighting poverty. A VISTA project's goal is to support efforts that address poverty and poverty-related problems that individuals and communities are experiencing in the United States. Next, VISTA strives to empower communities. We want to engage residents and the people who will benefit from the project in the planning, the development, and the implementation of the project. Third, Zista focuses on capacity building. By that, we mean that the goal of every project and member is to strengthen and increase the reach of anti-poverty initiatives in coordination with staff, with community members, and other community volunteers. And lastly, Vista tries to create sustainable solutions. We want the capacity developed through the Vista project to continue even after the Vista resources are gone. So during their service, Vista members develop systems, relationships, and knowledge which they transfer to the organization and the community to sustain over the long term. Before we go further, I want to note a few definitions and terms that will help you understand our structure. We've already introduced a few terms to you. The first term is a VISTA project or just project. A VISTA project means a set of activities operated and overseen by a sponsor. What's a sponsor? A sponsor or a VISTA sponsor or a VISTA project sponsor all mean the same thing, but that refers to a public agency or a private nonprofit organization that receives assistance through AmeriCorps and is responsible for operating and overseeing a VISTA project. A public agency may be a state, local, or tribal government. Like I said, private nonprofits are also eligible sponsors. The next term is project director or VISTA project director, and that refers to a staff person of the sponsor who's been assigned by that sponsor the overall responsibility for the management of the individual VISTA project. The project directors are responsible for executing all aspects of the project as outlined by the sponsor. The next term is supervisor. Supervisor is an individual, may or may not be the project director, but that person is the person who directly supervises a VISTA member. Now, this can be at the project level or at a partner site level, and we'll talk about projects and partner sites in a few slides. But all VISTA member supervisors are trained, and AmeriCorps provides a virtual supervisor training for supervisors. The last term is regional office or AmeriCorps regional office. Our agency, AmeriCorps, has field staff working throughout the United States. There are 8 regional offices representing all 50 states, the District of Columbia, and U.S. territories. Those regional offices help develop, support, and facilitate VISTA projects through their entire project lifecycle, and they're a critical resource to organizations who want to apply to become a VISTA sponsor. Okay, now is a good time for me to take a little bit of a breath and for us to hear more from you. We're gonna do a little poll here that Mike is bringing up. And we're assuming that you're joining today's presentation as a representative of an organization that's interested in applying for VISTA resources. Maybe you've already talked to one of our regional office teams. Maybe you've looked on our website or taken the VISTA 101 course. We'd like to know what type of organization that you are representing today. So we've got this poll here. Please select which organization type from the list that most closely resembles yours. I know we've probably not covered everyone, but we've got local nonprofits, statewide nonprofits, multi-state nonprofits, again, all eligible to be VISTA sponsors or partners. We have public agencies like city or municipal governments, state governments, tribal organizations or tribal governments. And we also have educational institutions, higher ed, HBCUs, and other kinds of higher ed. So we've got some results here. It looks like a good percentage of you are representing local nonprofits. That's great. We'll talk in just a slide about the kind of community partners that we work with. And often we're working with local nonprofits. We've got larger statewide nonprofits as well, multi-state, and some state government. And we've got most of the waterfront covered here. So that's great to see. That's great to see. Thanks, Mike. Okay, let's jump back into our VISTA overview there. and look at some of Vista's annual accomplishments, which you can see on the slide here. And aside from those shining faces on the left of your screen of Vista members, you'll see some simple statistics on the right that we think convey the breadth and the design of the Vista program really nicely. And in terms of the size of the program, you can see that in a recent year, the Vista program engaged over 8,500 members at thousands of community sites across the U.S., again, 4,500 locations across the U.S. Those types of organizations that we just referenced on the prior slide, those nonprofit organizations, those institutes of higher education, those public agencies. And in terms of program design, we talked earlier about Vista's core principles. One of those is capacity building, and another is sustainability. And you can see here from some of these statistics that Vista members really have a multiplier effect in communities across the U.S., mobilizing local resources. Those 8,500 Vista members that I mentioned helped mobilize 800,000 other community volunteers in just one year, and more than $200 million in cash and in-kind resources to support that local organization's efforts to address poverty and to fulfill the goals of the project and other corresponding events. So we're really proud of these statistics. You can see here the last note, we've been doing this since 1965 and have hundreds of thousands of alums, and I think these results are really powerful. So let's go from the typical year annual accomplishments of the whole Vista program collectively and zoom in on the accomplishments of a single project. And here we're looking at the Homeless and Housing Coalition of Kentucky, which is an example of a great project with multiple partners. And we'll talk about multiple partner projects and single site projects in a slide or two, but this is a multiple partner project. This project serves both urban and rural areas, and they've seen impressive results from the capacity building activities of Vista members. And the reason that this project exists is that in many areas, it's challenging for individuals to access housing services and to obtain third-party verification of status as a person experiencing homelessness. And this is one of the ways that an organization might address poverty in their community by helping individuals who are experiencing homelessness. And many local organizations just can't reach as many individuals as they would like to. So in this project, which again is fairly large, 23 Vistas provided capacity building services to 12 different community agencies. And those Vista members helped write funding proposals. They recruited community volunteers. They engaged in outreach efforts to expand the resources and reach of their partners. And as a result of those capacity building efforts, those 23 Vista members leveraged thousands of volunteers. They helped raise more than $1.5 million in cash and in-kind resources. And ultimately, more individuals who needed housing placement services got them. So this project is continuing to build processes and systems to reach sustainability of those activities, but it's a one that we wanted to highlight for you. And the next project is not quite as large, but we're going to keep our eye on Kentucky and look at another project of that we have for you. And this is the Audubon Community Services project, which also is a project in this one in rural western Kentucky. And this has just five Vistas over the last year. This organization has recruited and managed new community volunteers. They've created resource directories. They've conducted outreach and more to help individuals who are dealing with opioid issues. They're trying to prevent the use and abuse of opioids and to help those folks who are experiencing addiction get treatment. And one of their highlights was implementing a recovery celebration, which more than 600 community members turned out for. So again, not all of our projects look the same. Here are just a couple of examples. I'm going to turn it over to Stephanie, who's going to talk more about sponsoring organizations. Stephanie?
Yeah, great. Thanks, Rob. So now that we have just a basic understanding of what Vista really is about, let's go ahead and talk a little bit more about the role of our project sponsors. So we have just a couple of different program models. The first and most basic VISTA program model is what we call a single site sponsor. So this really refers to just one agency that's hosting a VISTA project at one site. In this type of model, the VISTA member or the members would be serving at that site. So the VISTA supervisor and members, again, would all be serving at or focused on that same site. An intermediary sponsor, on the other hand, is a VISTA sponsor, which helps provide resources to other eligible organizations. So oftentimes these other organizations really, they're much smaller and they may not actually have the capacity to access such federal resources on their own. So the intermediary really does serve as an organization that has the capacity to develop and to support multiple VISTA sites across a wide geographic area, or sometimes among a group of organizations that are focused on addressing a common community need. They also provide administrative services, technical support, training, as well as oversight to those sub-sites. An intermediary organization can partner with a separate organization to place VISTA members, or the intermediary organization may place VISTA members at their own chapter or affiliate sites. So effective project management really is an essential part of a successful VISTA project, as well as a great high-quality member experience. There's a lot of phases and activities, of course, that's related to planning and implementing as well as executing a project. Today, I'm just going to touch on three of these components for our sponsoring organizations to focus on. So first, we want to be sure that you develop your proposed project with community members. So Rob alluded to this earlier, but community members really are kind of the backbone of the project. So community members from the population that you intend to serve, they really understand the community's needs and wishes, and they bring that key perspective in the planning and implementation and even the evaluation of your proposed project. So the community's guidance and support and buy-in really is instrumental for the project's success. Next, we also have performance measures. And of course, performance measures really are important to our work and they help ensure that a project stays on track. So we have national performance measures from which you can select, of course, with input and guidance from our regional field staff as needed. So the regional office can help you refine your project plan and also ensure that the needs of the community as well as the VISTA program are being met. You'll be required to report on the performance measures that you select semi-annually. The information that you provide in these reports really demonstrate your project's results and lets us know how things are going, as well as how you're managing the resources. It also allows our regional staff to provide you with better technical assistance, again, just to ensure the success of your project. And so lastly, as I've already kind of alluded to here, project sponsors, of course, complete a couple of reports that give us that information about the project status. Again, successes, challenges, you know, what's going on so that our staff can really best support your project. So I mentioned, of course, the project progress reports, or PPRs, as we like to call them. These are completed twice a year. And so again, the information submitted in this report becomes a part of the project's official record. And so this is taken into consideration when our staff are evaluating whether or not a project will be continued in future years. We do have PPR guidance that's developed to assist you with writing and submitting your report. And of course, I've mentioned the intermediary structure. So if you do develop a project with multiple sites, you're going to want to make sure that you establish a way to collect and aggregate information from all of your members serving at those various sites so that you can roll that data up and include it in the report and really submit a comprehensive report. And we also have one other report that you'll be responsible for completing. It's the VISTA Progress Report Supplement, or the VPRS, as we like to call it. And so this annual report really tracks the demographic information for your project. It's typically due in mid-November and is based on our agency's fiscal year as opposed to the project year for your organization. So this makes the reporting period October 1st through September 30th of each year. And so to report on this specific time frame, it's really helpful to make sure that you're tracking information from your members on a monthly basis, and that helps ensure that you're able to compile that data and submit it. And again, we have plenty of resources available to help you complete this report as well. And you can find a link to an informational webinar, as well as instructions on how to complete this report in the VISTA Sponsor Resource Guide, which of course is made available to all of our sponsors. So some of the most important responsibilities of a sponsoring organization includes the actual managing of the VISTA members. So as a sponsor, you'll be responsible for drafting those catchy opportunity listings so that you can announce your position and really to attract those top quality candidates. In addition, you'll be recruiting and screening and interviewing and recommending the best candidates for service. The recruitment and placement of VISTA members can take place on our web-based platform, in addition to any other recruitment avenues that you identify. We've developed some social media graphics and messages and some other promotional items to help you assist with these efforts. Sponsors also must provide an in-depth orientation to all new and incoming VISTA members at the beginning of their service. We also expect sponsors to provide ongoing training and professional development opportunities to the members throughout their service year. And of course, I'm sure it's no surprise to you that the best projects really provide that quality day-to-day supervision and support of their members. This includes kind of introducing and orienting the VISTA into the community as well as into your organization, really confirming that the members have the space and the supplies and the equipment that they need to be successful and to carry out their service year. It includes providing reasonable accommodations to members who request them based on different abilities. And of course, having those regular check-ins and really ensuring that the members' actual activities are in line with their approved VISTA assignment description. Sponsors are also required to complete what we call the sponsor verification form. This is an online form that's completed every 2 weeks, and this just serves as a confirmation that your VISTA members are still actively serving with the project. You'll learn more about this in the full application process if your concept paper is accepted. So before applying for VISTA resources, it's incredibly important to really understand the difference between the VISTA program and the other AmeriCorps programs. So a VISTA member service is meant to expand the scale, the reach, efficiency, or the effectiveness of programs or organizations. So to do this, the project activities should focus primarily on capacity building instead of that direct service. So let's think about what this looks like in practice. Let's go ahead and consider an after-school tutoring project. So a VISTA member that's focused on indirect service and capacity building, they may be involved in activities like creating volunteer applications and assignment descriptions for after-school tutors, or they could be designing a system to effectively recruit and place community volunteers as tutors. They may also be responsible for designing volunteer trainings and materials and even a handbook to support the program. So one thing that all of us have in common is that those systems and the resources created by the member, they're going to remain in place long after the VISTA has completed their service. However, if we think about some of our other programs, such as AmeriCorps State or NCCC, those members may be engaged in what we call direct service. So they could actually be involved in tutoring the children. So while VISTA members may do some limited direct service, their service activities really should not focus on these types of direct service activities with the beneficiary population. So if this is the type of service that your organization really needs, and having a VISTA member or a team of VISTA members come in to create a community volunteer program isn't feasible for you at this time, then you may want to check out one of our other programs. It may be a better fit for your organization. You can find a lot more about all of our programs on our website at AmeriCorps.gov. Okay, so while the VISTA program doesn't have a required match, we do expect sponsors to provide members with the resources and the support they need to be successful. Additionally, we also encourage our sponsors to participate in our cost share program. This is a strategy in which the sponsoring organization pays the living allowance for one or more of its AmeriCorps VISTA members. This really is an effective way for the VISTA program to reach more communities all across the nation. In the cost share partnership, the sponsoring organization receives an invoice for the associated members' living allowance costs. So you can see here on the slide, there's several benefits, of course, to the cost share partnership. This really does, like I said, includes really increasing the number of VISTAs perhaps that your agency receives, and also really expanding the number of VISTA resources that we have across the country. Additionally, it shows your organization's commitment to the project. So again, while cost sharing is encouraged, it's not required. As a sponsor, you'll learn more about this process as well as some of the benefits associated with cost sharing when you talk with your assigned portfolio manager from the regional office. So now that I've given you an overview of the VISTA program, some of our various models and sponsoring organizations' responsibilities, I'm going to go ahead and turn things over to my colleague, Kelly. Kelly, take it away.
Did not come off. Now that you have background information about the VISTA program and the role of our project sponsors, I want to focus on the resource you're really here to learn about, our VISTA members. In this segment, I'll go over the eligibility for the members that might serve on your project, their work, and the corresponding benefits. On the slide, you can see the basic requirements for anyone applying to become a VISTA member. In addition, most important, 18 years of age and older, keeping in mind that the most people think of VISTAs as recent college grads. However, while that's the typical image of an AmeriCorps member, a significant percentage of VISTAs are actually baby boomers, people who've just retired, who bring a wide array of professional and life experience to their VISTA assignments. These different life perspectives and experiences provide a unique lens from which each member views the world and tackles issues at the community level. It's about recruiting people that will best serve your project and interact with the community and your sponsor. Some things to focus on: VISTAs are members. They are not employees either of your organization or of AmeriCorps. They're not interns or volunteers. Here, terminology does matter. VISTAs serve, they do not work, and they receive a modest living allowance that aligns with the community they are serving. So if you are in New York City, your VISTAs will make more than if you're in rural Montana. VISTA members pursue their assignments for a variety of reasons, ranging from wanting to make a difference and eliminating poverty to learning new career skills and networking. Some other facts, again, local or national recruits, we pay for relocation. So if you want to recruit people locally or bring people in, it's about getting someone with the skills to make your project successful. There's some other facts about the members are on the slide. We also have a type of VISTA member. They're VISTA leaders. Projects with 8 or more VISTAs might have a leader. These are members who've served a year in VISTA or AmeriCorps or more, and also now return Peace Corps volunteers. The leaders help you as a project supervisor recruit, mentor, train, and coordinate report writing, and generally support teams of members, either all located at your site or if they're spread out at other sites. They can guide data collection and help you interpret the data, but they cannot actually complete the reporting activities and e-grants. That is a sponsor's job. They provide a lot of assistance in building esprit de corps of your teams. And if you are applying for a larger project, you'll want to talk to your portfolio manager about the possibility of getting a VISTA leader. Now that you know who VISTAs and VISTA leaders are, let's take a look at what they actually do. So, what do members do? Their impact on the communities they serve is invaluable. So our sponsors tell us. Excuse me. VISTAs provide capacity building to your organizations and work to empower the communities you serve and lift them out of poverty. It's done in many different ways based on your organization, the assignment, and the community's needs. Members are key in building and maintaining partnerships and collaborating with other organizations and stakeholders. They create programs, including volunteer management systems and trainings, and also participate in various aspects of development and fundraising for their project. VISTAs do all of this while living at the same level as the communities that they serve. As you can see, VISTA members and leaders participate in a wide array of different activities. And while there are countless unique projects and activities that are perfect for VISTA members, there are definitely some that are prohibited. On the slide coming up, you'll see a list of what VISTA members cannot do. Prior to their service, VISTA members attend a virtual members orientation where they complete online courses which details what they can and cannot do during service. That way, both you and your VISTAs are fully informed about the prohibited activities. Our agency, particularly our Inspector General, takes this very seriously, as should all our sponsors. Because the VISTA program is focused solely on serving American communities, members cannot work on any international projects, including setting up service trips abroad, engaging in religious instruction, conducting worship services, or engaging in any form of proselytizing during service time is prohibited. There are also some prohibited political activities. A VISTA cannot engage in political activities while in service, such as fundraising for a partisan political campaign or identifying themselves as a VISTA while engaging in political activities. Along those same lines, VISTAs cannot be involved in voter registration, even if your organization does that type of work. In general, VISTAs cannot engage in or support political activity, religious activity, lobbying, or union organizing as part of their service or while perceived to be serving as a VISTA. And then finally, let's move on to the topic of supplanting staff or existing volunteer positions. This is critical. Members shall not perform duties that should be done or have typically been done by your paid staff, existing volunteers, or contractors. The role of the VISTA is building capacity and to bring your communities out of poverty and to be sustainable. So the VISTAs come in, do their work, and eventually the work will continue on without them. Now that we have covered the do's and don'ts of VISTA service, let's review some of the member benefits. On the screen, you'll see the living allowance, the end of service award. We have two options, the AmeriCorps Education Award or the cash stipend. Another benefit is non-competitive eligibility, which helps give you an edge in the federal hiring process, as well as adding on to your time for retirement. And in some cases, it'll count towards state government.
Okay.
And now I'll turn it back over to Rob.
Thanks, Kelly.
Sorry.
Thanks. Up to this point, we've given you an overview of the VISTA program, some of the members' roles, the do's and don'ts, and the benefits and sponsor responsibilities. Now we're going to focus on a little bit of the nitty-gritty about the application process. How do you become a project and the steps that an organization would take to become a VISTA sponsor, including some of our programming priorities for this year for new projects. And there are two broad steps to the VISTA program application process. First, the interested organization submits a concept paper. AmeriCorps reviews the concept paper to gain a better understanding of the proposed project and to determine if the activities and the organization are in alignment with VISTA's programming priorities. So this is really a preliminary screening tool used to to figure out if the organization would be a good fit. We have four deadlines each year for when organizations can submit concept papers, and we'll review that timeline in a few slides. If AmeriCorps accepts the concept paper, then we move to the second step. The organization is invited to submit a project application, and our AmeriCorps regional office staff is available to provide technical assistance and guidance during the writing of both the concept paper, that first step, and the VISTA project application, the second step. And I would, again, really strongly encourage you to take advantage of that technical assistance. To create a concept paper, applicants use specific concept paper instructions, which can be found on our AmeriCorps.gov website. We'll have some links later in the slide deck for you. Those concept paper instructions contain details on how to submit the concept paper and what to include in it. And the picture here on the left shows the cover page of those instructions. We try not to keep secrets here, so we wanted to highlight several characteristics that we associate with strong concept papers. And the first characteristic is that strong concept papers align with AmeriCorps focus areas and programming priorities. We will talk about those in a moment. Also, strong concept papers match up with VISTA's core principles, which we talked about earlier. Again, that means the concept paper clearly demonstrates how the project is supporting efforts to address poverty and how the sponsor will involve community members in project development and implementation. Strong concept papers also identify how the service of VISTA members will lead to increased capacity and sustainability of the anti-poverty initiative, and how that the efforts will generate public or private sector resources and promote local volunteer service. Strong concept papers are also those that are specific in painting a clear picture of project goals and activities. So it would be clear to a reader what is really trying to be accomplished. When in doubt, again, reach out to your local AmeriCorps regional office for technical assistance and more tips with writing a strong concept paper. I mentioned that strong concept papers align with AmeriCorps focus areas and our program priorities. Each year, AmeriCorps issues program guidance that outlining the next year's priority areas for new project development. And the program guidance for the current year that we're in, which began October 1st, that's FY21 for the federal government, fiscal year 21 for the federal government, is available now, and it can be found on our website, AmeriCorps.gov. Again, we'll have a link for that later in the slides. The annual program guidance is a key resource that you'll want to look through, but we want to highlight some of the priorities for you today. Broadly speaking, this year, VISTA wants to support organizations that are addressing critical needs during the COVID-19 pandemic. And in addition to the effects of the pandemic, which research tells us disproportionately affects Black communities and other communities of color, the longstanding racial inequities in our country have been elevated to a national conversation, and we believe that economic inequity is inexorably linked to the history of racial inequity, and AmeriCorps is committed to addressing that this year. So we will focus on awarding projects that advance racial equity and increase opportunity. And so we'll just walk through a few highlights. One of our focus areas is economic opportunity. That includes supporting programs that transition individuals into or help individuals to remain in safe and affordable housing. It includes employment, including improving or creating job skills training programs and other sort of employment programs. It includes bridging the digital divide. We know that folks still have trouble with access to computers and to high-speed internet, and so programs that help individuals experiencing poverty with that, as well as building the skills to effectively use that technology, is a priority for us this year. The VISTA program will give priority to projects that meet health needs for economically disadvantaged individuals in terms of access to healthcare, as well as food security. Another area of focus for new projects, again, is helping everyone have a healthy future. So that covers both access to healthcare and food security. We know that there is a lot of disparities in healthcare access as a result of the pandemic. So we know food security and access to healthcare are critical during this period. So we think likely some potential food security partners may include food banks and pantries, networks of food banks and school systems and after school programs, but I'm sure there are many others. The VISTA program has historically had a strong footprint in supporting programs that address the headwinds that many young people face in their educational pursuits. And this year, we will again support projects that enhance access to services and resources that contribute to improved educational outcomes for economically disadvantaged children, in getting prepared for school, in having success from kindergarten through 12th grade, and in their post-secondary pursuits, whether that be higher education or some sort of other employment or career pursuits. And finally, AmeriCorps VISTA continues to support projects that focus on low-income veterans and military families as beneficiaries. And priorities for that include the areas that we previously discussed, things like housing and employment, education, access to health services, and so forth. Now, some of you may already have ideas for what you are trying to accomplish with your organization. I would expect that you would. And we'd like to just pause and do another poll. We won't spend too much time here, but we'd like to hear from you. What sort of programming do you have in mind for this VISTA project? It's okay if you're not sure at this point. But you can see some of the focus areas that I just mentioned. We've got housing. And hopefully you're seeing this poll up on your computer. Sometimes it takes a few moments. Go ahead and complete that poll. We've got housing, employment or workforce development, a digital divide, access to healthcare, food security, school readiness, K through 12 success, post-secondary success. You've got an option for more than one of the above. We know that poverty is a complicated issue. It's a complex issue. It's hard to just put things in buckets like that. And many folks have multiple dimensions for their projects. And in some cases, maybe these don't represent what you are trying to accomplish. And that's okay too. We're talking about priority programming. It doesn't mean that if you don't have something up on the list that I just mentioned, that you wouldn't be considered for a VISTA project this year. So let's see where we are with the poll, Mike. Okay, so housing, we've got employment, obviously lots of folks experiencing challenges in this environment, digital divide, access to healthcare, again, a broad, and a lot of folks with more than one of the above, right? We know that these buckets don't tell the full story. Okay. Well, thank you for that. And we're just going to jump back in to Kelly. Do you want to talk a little bit more about the concept paper submission process? Again, some of the nuts and bolts here.
Absolutely. Thanks, Rob. Organizations applying to AmeriCorps for any of our resources will use what we call e-grants. And you see the screens on the right. Very important to notice it's not grants.gov, which some federal agencies use, but our own system. The basics that you'll need is your organization's name, your EIN number, and that's for all types, whether you're local government or a nonprofit, and contact information. Once you create an organizational account and log in, you'll go to the lower left side of the screen and you'll see, click on the concept paper. You'll click on that and that will bring up the application. In the next window, you would click on FY 2021 AmeriCorps Vista State New NOFO. It should be the only option you see. In terms of the concept paper, you'll be asked some basic questions like anticipating the length of your project, most last between 3 to 5 years. You also see sections asking you to select the focus areas and objectives that we talked about before that align with your proposed project. You'll be also giving us the geographic areas that will be served by your project. And a tip for that one is to just please list the cities, towns, and states. We are not looking for narrative in that section. If you're a former grantee or sponsor, there are a few additional questions that you'll also need to answer. The concept paper is only 4 narrative sections, and they'll allow you to explain your proposed project under these categories. In the needs section, you'll explain the unmet poverty-related needs that you propose to address. Under strengthening communities, you should describe how your project aims to complement or expand the current efforts taking place in the community to address your identified need. The organizational capability questions are looking for you to detail your organization's capacity to manage a federal national service program. And finally, an optional field for those that are interested in becoming intermediaries by having multiple sites, you'll be asked a number of questions to justify that. If you're not applying as an intermediary, you just have to write not applicable in that field. Again, the very specific instructions are on the concept paper instructions. We're just giving a broad overview here. We do recommend that you write your responses in WordPad as opposed to a more branded word processing software to avoid extra characters from appearing in your submission and taking up space. This also allows you to conduct a spell check on your work. Unfortunately, our system does not have that. The green check mark indicates that you're done. Orange means you still need to finish that response. And again, be sure to respond directly to the questions in the concept paper instructions. Now let's take a look at the key dates. Our deadline coming up is January 4th, 2021 at 11:59 p.m. We have 2 other deadlines this fiscal year. Projects take from start to finish anywhere from 3 to 6 months to start up. So it's important to plan ahead. If you're a large intermediary, you may take longer. So just keep in mind, these are the 4 times a year that we take concept paper applications. The regional office conducts the reviews and they'll notify applicants of their decision for this next cycle in February 2021. If a concept paper is accepted, the applicant is then invited to submit the full application. Once you submit, you'll get an acknowledgement from your regional office. And to help you with your full application, the system will automatically copy over the 4 responses you gave, as well as the other information into your application record. The questions expand on what you'll have the VISTAs do. It includes a simple budget. We do not offer cash grants in the first year of a project, so you'll primarily be giving us the slots and where those slots will be and the living allowance. And your portfolio manager will be assigned to work with you on the application, will provide all the information you need. We provide virtual trainings for project directors and supervisors to get acquainted with their roles once you're awarded an application, along with the member placement and recruitment activities, such as writing service opportunity listings and creating VISTA assignment descriptions. The application honestly is not that hard. Once you see the applications, it's just pulling together the information. There are some attachment requirements like proof of nonprofit status. But again, because VISTA is not a competitive program, your AmeriCorps portfolio manager can provide technical assistance throughout the application process. I see one question asking if an organization has an AmeriCorps program from a different project, can you use the existing eGrants account? Absolutely. Organizations should only have one eGrants account with all of their awards listed under that. You do not need to create multiple accounts. Now that I've gone over the application process and just the first piece of it, admittedly, I'd like to review some resources to help you along the way. So closing out, we have a list of resources that you'll be able to link to when we send out the PDF and to help you determine whether your organization would like to apply for VISTA. Again, most important, your regional office contact. You can, if the state you are located in to reach the staff, you just have to use ny@cns.gov or al@cns.gov, the initials of your state @cns.gov, will email the staff responsible for management of your state. We have links here to the instructions, as well as the program guidance. And if you need technical assistance with eGrants, we have the National Service Hotline. But again, remember, your regional office is your main point of contact to provide guidance and technical assistance when writing your concept paper and developing your project.
Perfect. Kelly, I'm gonna jump in here while we've just got one or two slides left. And I see just a couple minutes left in our hour. And I see some questions coming through the Q&A and the chat, yep. And I wanna make sure that we spend a little time and get to those. So I'm gonna read out some of the questions that we've gotten and invite Stephanie and Kelly to join in. One of the questions that we received was about, let's see, is there a minimum or maximum or recommended number of VISTA members that a new project should be looking to support? And what I would say to that is really, it depends on what you're trying to accomplish. So, you know, we are trying to fit the resources to what your goals are, and our regional offices, with that technical assistance, they have the expertise of knowing, you know, what can a person reasonably accomplish in a year, in a yearly assignment, and they can help work with you to figure that out. That being said, you know, there is some cost or effort to submitting a concept paper, to getting this off of the ground. And in some cases, I would not be shy about asking for more than one VISTA member, a couple, four or five. And in some cases that, if you've got the scope of work mapped out correctly, that's something that the regional office may be willing to take an even harder look at. If you've got, so I wouldn't be shy about asking for a minimum. There's technically not a minimum, but I think, you know, I would err on the side of asking for more and then working back from there. We've got another question about, can you apply to be a VISTA sponsor, to sponsor a VISTA project that only uses summer associates? And we didn't talk too much about summer associates today. Those are a sort of a very specialized group of folks. The short answer is no. Summer associates can only be part of projects that are using full year VISTAs, so a larger project. So that's where we see summer associates come in for projects that are already up and running and are utilizing VISTAs who serve a full term of service through our traditional program. We've got another question. Can you elaborate on VISTA not being competitive? So that's a great question. We use that's sort of a term of art that we use around here, and it's good to clarify. So when we think of competitive, there are a lot of grant programs, especially with the federal government, where a pot of resources is made available. Folks are encouraged to apply for that pot of resources, and the folks who are providing the funding, for example, AmeriCorps, the federal government, once the application process gets to a certain point, they are not allowed to talk to individual applicants for fear that it might be unfair to other folks who are applying, because it's a competition for those resources. And so when we talk sometimes about VISTA not being competitive, we of course have limited resources. We don't have all of the limited resources in the world. So in some sense, we're receiving concept papers, and the best concept papers and proposals will be able to move forward. But we're not competing for resources in the same way. We will be able to, our staff are able to talk to all applicants on their particular application without intrusion or fear of not having a sense of fairness. So again, that's why we're encouraging you. This is a more unique, or I won't say unique, but a different way of being able to work with organizations to help support them and suss out their ideas, these regional offices. So a great resource that I would encourage you to take advantage of. Let's see, let me just pause there. Kelly, Stephanie, any other comments that are jumping out to you that we should try to tackle here?
Let's see. If a prospective sponsor proposes cost sharing, does it make your application more competitive? Not generally in the first year. If we are right at our budget, then possibly, but it's more about fulfilling a state's programmatic portfolio. For instance, if they have a lot of education projects, they're going to look more favorably on workforce, other types of needs. We talked to the states about having a rounded portfolio. And of course, some issue areas change every year, but it doesn't necessarily get you a leg ahead. It would get you members placed possibly a little sooner, but not the application itself. I also see one, what's the average cost to the sponsor per VISTA? Unless you're cost sharing, where we invoice you for the member's living allowance, there is no cost other than what you provide in in-kind. So your supervisor's time, the space and materials. If you were to get a cash grant in your second or third or subsequent year, we do not have a match requirement, unlike some of the other grant programs. So it's what you're putting towards the project, but you will only, in terms of writing that check, only ever do that for the living allowance.
Thanks, Kelly. I'm just going to just clarify one or two more things, and then we'll close out here because I know we're at time. And they are related to the cost share program. So you just talked about that. Not all VISTA sponsors cost share. There are costs that you would contribute to the project. But in terms of paying, for example, some of the benefits that members get directly, like a living allowance, like some access to healthcare a benefit or childcare benefit, VISTA members upon completing their service receive an education award. That is covered by the federal government. That is covered by AmeriCorps. What sponsors are contributing is a desk, a space for that or that individual to work, the resources needed for local supervision and making sure that you're able to meet some of the responsibilities that we talked about here. But that's one of the great things about the AmeriCorps VISTA program is early on in this first year, unless you're cost sharing, these members are coming with benefits provided directly from AmeriCorps, and the sponsor's obligations are to support that individual and to run the project without having to deal with the hassle of a fiscal grant. One last question came in about submitting a concept paper for VISTA, but if there seems to be a better fit for one of our other organizations we mentioned, maybe AmeriCorps Seniors or the Senior Corps program it was formerly known, could the application transfer to another program? And The short answer to that is nope. Each of our programs have their own application structure. They have their own program designs. They have their own intents. So although some of the problems in communities may be similar, the approaches and the way that these resources are designed to be utilized are quite different. And so we have different application structures for each. So I know there are some other great questions in the chat. We're already a little bit past time. So I want to thank you all for joining us today. Hopefully you received some great information. You do choose to reach out to your AmeriCorps regional office. That's your best next step. And we will be making this presentation recorded and posted onto our website in the coming days. Thank you again so much for joining us. Have a great day.